teachers whom I now miss immeasurably. Of course, my juniors who are so anxious here today. Trauma and stress that 11th and 12th and all these crucial years bring to a student's mind. So today I'm here to just assist you all with university application processes, which I have been applying to many universities in the US and UK. So these two countries are what I can assist you with. And so about me, I studied at DPS and I chose the stream BCM with economics because slowly after taking science I realized that I was very interested in business. So my major, the app major that I found for myself was materials engineering and entrepreneurship, because through this I can make my own product with engineering and then sell it in the market, because that's what I wish to do. So in US and UK I've been accepted to two Ivy Leagues, the Cornell University and University of Pennsylvania, and out of which I've chosen Cornell University. Then I got accepted into very good, amazing schools, which made the choice very little. I got into Georgia Tech, University of Chicago, and California Berkeley. So without wasting any time, I'll just help you all with the things that you need to do. So your map that you should have clearly in your mind is that, number one, you're supposed to create your application, and I do not think you should waste any time, because 12th graders, it's high time. You are a little late, so you must begin right now. And 11th grade, it's a perfect time. So if you want to be on time and you want to do everything planned and appropriately, so you must create your application by now. Then your academic record, your marks, which is absolutely fundamental to whether or not you get into your dream universities. Then your essays and your personal statements, which tell the university what you are, apart from numbers. And extracurricular profile, which applies only to the states. And then you have summers and internships, which again helps your application in a great way. Then you have letters of recommendations and your counselor. And then financial aids and scholarships. So one by one, I'll tackle each of them. So I'll begin with US because that's what I'm more experienced with. UK was just a backup for me. So US, convenient website for your application. Can I please have some silence? Thank you. So the application should be created on Common App. All US universities, as you might be knowing, accept the Common App, except a few, like the University of California, all its campuses, Berkeley, San Diego, LA, all of them, do not take the Common App. So you will create your application for these six universities on their personal websites and University of Illinois. So the Common App looks like that, and by now you must register yourselves. So in US, what confuses most of us is the types of applications that they have. So there are three kinds. You have early application, early decision, and regular decision. Now the first two, the EA and ED, these are supposed to be done in 12th grade. Their deadline approaches in month of October end, so that's November 1st is usually the deadline. So in early application, the difference between these two actually, which confuses most of us, is that early application may or may not bind you to applying to only that particular school. You may apply to 7 or 8 colleges early, but early decision, you cannot apply to more than one specific college. Now, when I applied early, I applied to Harvard, and I applied via early application, but Harvard has something else called restricted early application. That means that you can apply only to Harvard. So when I applied early, I was able to apply only to Harvard, but I got deferred to the regular round. That means they did not accept it in the early round, so they told me to apply again in the regular, but the same thing. And then regular decision, it comes in January. So that's your final, the January 1st deadline is your final deadline to apply to US colleges. Mostly here and there, it depends on the your personal colleges. So you must keep in mind the college that you're applying to, and always keep a track of their deadlines, because you do not want to miss out on applying only because you didn't meet the dates. So as I just said, do it now. And for UK, the convenient website is UCAS. So as you can see, that's how it looks. And but there still are a few other colleges that do accept applications only on their personal personal websites. So this also you must do right now. Now academics. This is what this is the base of your application. So I always say that if you have good grades, you have a chance at getting in, but if you have bad grades, you are surely rejected. So your grades are what gives the college the incentive to at least look at the rest of your application. So number one is the SAT. Now, the SAT consists of reading, writing, math, no calculator, and math calculator. Now, I'll be explaining from my personal experience how I have written the SAT and what I found difficult. So, the reading section, as most of you may know by now, is very, very difficult on the SAT one. So, you do have very little time, and each passage has almost 80 to 90 lines. So it's very difficult to read all of them with such difficult vocabulary and attempt the questions in such little time. So reading, I found quite difficult, and that's where I lost my marks. And writing is pretty simple. It's just basic punctuation and grammar. Math, no calculator, is quite easy because they do not let you use the calculator, so you don't have lengthy calculations. It's just simple algebra and geometry. And math calculator, you have, it's a little tricky, but that's just a few questions towards the end, like 9 or 10 questions may be very difficult. The rest are still quite, you can attempt them. And there's an optional essay, which you may or may not write, but I highly suggest that you do write the essay, because other candidates who may have written the optional essay will be given more weightage than you if you do not write the essay. So do go ahead and attempt this essay, it's not very difficult. So now, on the SAT, what I feel is that it has no other section except math and English. So if you haven't taken science, SAT is your only option. So you must go ahead and begin practicing for the SAT now. Because the best way to do that is actually take a diagnostic test, the first thing, know where you're lacking, and then focus on only your weak points. Because you can't start studying for the SAT from scratch, because you're late to do that. And the SAT does not want to see how fast you can study and attempt the paper. It's just your build-up knowledge from all these years. And when to take the SAT? Now, I'll be speaking with respect to 12th grade. The current 12th graders should attempt their first SAT by June 2nd. Even if you have, I know you have June exams coming up and it's very difficult to focus on both CBSE and SAT, but the first attempt always helps you to get better acclimatized to how the testing pattern goes. So the first SAT, you can attempt it with very little preparation. Just go ahead, attempt it to know what the exam feels like, because it's a 4-hour exam, so if you don't know when the time gets finished and how things work, you will mess up. So the first SAT should always be a try. Then after that, you have summer holidays. Use them very wisely. Attempt your second and final attempt in August, because if you do not score as well on the SAT as you wished to in your second try with full preparation, assuming that you've prepared as well as you can and you still didn't score very well on the SAT, there's no point of giving it again, because there's very little difference that studying more can make to your marks. So it's best you give it just twice, limit yourself to 2 attempts and focus on other important things. Now, one thing I've seen is when people start comparing SAT marks, like if someone gets a 15-30 or if someone gets a 15-60, there's no difference between those two. So there's no point of giving SAT again and again for 30 marks, because even college officers know that 30 marks up and down may just be because that day some questions were difficult. So don't worry about that, just give it twice and do your best on the second attempt. Now, another alternative to the SAT in US colleges, apart from the SAT, in place of it, the ACT will also be accepted. So, the ACT does have a science section apart from all the other sections and a compulsory essay. Now, just a day back, I got a mail saying that ACT has become online now. So, the thing with ACT is that its reading is not as difficult as the reading is on the SAT. So if you think that your reading is not very well developed and you cannot attempt questions so quickly, I suggest that you take a look at ACT, do take a diagnostic exam, because for me personally, I did not do as well on the ACT as I wish I did. I just had to keep super scoring my marks in order to get the desired the number that I wanted. But on the ACT, in my first try, after a few practice tests, I managed to get a full score. So if you want to attempt, say, for Ivy Leagues or for very competitive colleges like MIT or Stanford, then you must try and write the ACT if you're science students, because the science is not difficult at all. It's just basic 9th and 10th passages they'll give you, and you just have to answer questions based on the passages. So do go ahead and try to attempt the ACT. So now if you're confused whether to write SAT or ACT, what I suggest is go home and on this weekend, take diagnostic tests. Do one diagnostic test for SAT, do one diagnostic test for ACT. Compare your marks, see what you found easier and what you can prepare well on. And then you'll know which test to take. And how to prepare for ACT, I think there's this book that I used. It's a 5-pound book of ACT practice problems. So this did help me a lot. Now the next exam is the SAT subject tests. Now most of us will not be applying only to US and UK. You will want to try for colleges in India as a backup, or maybe that's your goal. So SAT subject test is always recommended. If you have the SAT subject test, you will have an upper edge in every country. So because they're not very difficult to take, they're just 1-hour examinations and they don't require as much preparation, because physics, chem and math we do study in school as well. So if you have a good hold over your concepts, you will be able to attempt SAT subject tests without little preparation. I managed to get good scores without doing much. So if you people do want to go ahead in your application, do take the SAT subject test. And for preparation, most of you may know the Barron's books, they are excellent for SAT subject tests. Then you have your school exams and your transcripts, which are also very important. Do not go lax on these. So now since your 9th and 10th are already over, and you can't do anything about your 9th and 10th marks, whether they are high or low, nothing can be done about them. So I suggest that the current 11th graders, don't mess up this year, because most of us, when we come from 10th to 11th, it does become very difficult for us. And there's no pressure, but do try and perform your best. Don't think it's 11th and it's not a board exam, so it doesn't matter. Don't have that mentality. Do well in 11th grade as well, because US and UK universities both take your 11th grade marks. But the current 12th graders, if you feel that your 11th marks are not very great, don't stress. Just show the college an uplift in your 12th marks. So if they see a rise in your marks from 11th to 12th, they will know that if you get bad marks, you don't sulk about it, you do try and improve. So if your 11th grade marks are not very good, in 12th grade, do well in your June exams and try to get good predictive grades, because that will still help your application. And you have to do well in boards too, because your actual board marks have to match your predicted grades, plus minus 5. Because UK colleges, Canada colleges are also conditional. So you do have to show them the marks that were given in your predicted in the final exams as well. Now IELTS or TOEFL, these are the English proficiency tests. Because we're international students, we have to show the college that we know enough English to come and settle in their country and speak to their natives. So you have the IELTS and the TOEFL. Now because I was sure that I'll be applying only to few colleges in UK that accept TOEFL and US colleges, I wrote TOEFL, which I found pretty simple, because I didn't prepare much for it, but these are easy tests. You don't have to worry much about them. So I suggest that you go ahead and write IELTS and TOEFL right now. Don't waste much time, because they're easy tests. So over the summer break, in the first 2 weeks at least, finish off with this. It's just an additional headache. The sooner you get over it with it, the better it is for you. And now essays. Now, as I said, your marks only tell them what they need, but your essays will tell them why you are good for them. And this is what places you above the rest of the candidates. I personally feel that if I got into any Ivy League university or a top college, it's only because of my essays. Because that's what gives them an insight into who you are as a person. So for US, you have topic-specific essays in which they will give you a question and you simply have to answer that question in, say, 350 words or 650 words. You have to simply answer that question, so you must make sure that you stick to the topic. Don't deviate, don't tell them stories about yourself or anything like that. US just wants to see the answer to that question. So now you have a Common App essay, the main essay of yours that goes to every college you apply to. This essay must be outstanding, because some colleges may not have supplementary essays. So the Common App essay is all they need. So if it's all they need, you have to do your best. So over the summer break again, because you will not have such free time or free space in your mind, because towards the end of the year, say November, December, towards the deadlines, you will be very bombarded with, say, CBSE exams or any other entrances. So it's best that you think over your essays with a calm mind in the summer break, and by the end of the summer break, you should have at least the first draft of your essay ready. So be it US or a UK personal statement, which is generalized. You have to talk about yourself, your interests, why you chose the major. So these, you should mention everything, but I suggest that you get done with your essays in the summer break, because that's the best, most calm mind you will ever have. Next is extracurriculars. Now this applies only to US. In the Common App, you have space for fitting in 10 extracurriculars. Now just because they've given you 10 does not mean that you have to fill in all 10 to show them that you're very intelligent. No, that's not what you're supposed to do. 5 to 8 extracurriculars are suggested, because even the college knows that as a human being, you do not have enough time to do everything in the world. And if you are doing everything in the world, you're not spending enough time on each individual activity. So don't be fake. Show them only what you truly do, what your actual interest is. So if you, now I filled in say about 7 extracurriculars, because even your posts, your summer courses, your internships, all of them come in the extracurriculars. Or otherwise you can even go ahead and build your CV, but that's a little bit too much effort. So it's best you use the Common App 10 activities section and you show them that you are something apart from studies as well. Then you have portfolios. Now this is something that I feel is not very prevalent, most of us don't know about it, but my portfolio has personally helped me a lot, because I'm good at acting and dancing, so the college will not know that I'm good at acting if I just write it down that, oh, I'm good at acting. So it's best that I show them a video or a visual evidence of how I'm good at acting or dancing. So I submitted my portfolio to almost all top colleges that I applied to, and I do feel that somewhere this was responsible for me getting in. So I just have a small clipping of my portfolio. Videos of that and submit it to the college. Now for summers and internships. What I feel, again, added to my application was the fact that in 11th standard, I attended a summer program in engineering at Duke University. So that does show the college that you use your summers wisely and you don't waste any productive time. So that's what I think all of you must do if you're in 11th grade. It's the apt time to go and attend a summer program. And you can also attend online courses. I was reading about another one called MITx. It's from MIT University, and once you complete the course, you get a certificate stating that you have completed the course successfully. So if you submit this to the college, they will take it in a positive light. And even in UAE, there are a few options. Some universities like Manipal or WITS, they do offer robotics programs. So over the summer, try taking them. And for 12th graders, it's the apt time in summer. If you can spare, say, 3 to 4 weeks, don't take stress of it. But if you can take out this much time, go ahead and try for an internship. Because again, that shows the college that you're a responsible and mature adult who can face situations in college as well. Now your counselor. Now I cannot stress enough on this fact that your counselor has a very important role to play. So I do suggest that if you're in 11th and 12th, the first thing you must do is build good communication with your counselor, Vasudha ma'am. She will help you out in every way possible. So it's your prerogative to ensure that you do build good rapport and communication with her. Because three things that she will help you with is your transcripts. Your report cards are of no importance to the university. They only accept it if your marks are converted into official transcripts which are sent by the school. So you do have to use your counselor as a help for that. Then your counselor recommendation letter. Now again, this is very important because your counselor recommendation is fundamental to the college. They will see what your counselor thinks of you. So if your counselor does not know you at all, it will be very difficult for her to write a good recommendation letter for you. So if you want a good counselor recommendation letter, you must meet with her and she must know who you are as a person so that she's able to write you a good recommendation letter. And then your essays, she will also help you with your essays and reviewing them. Letters of recommendations also extend to your subject teachers. So you must make sure that you have strong letters of recommendation because these tell the college, it's a third person opinion of you. So this is the only external help your application gets. So make sure that you do arrange for very good recommendation letters. Can I please have some silence from the back? Thank you. Now when it comes to finances, this is something that restricts a lot of us because we get very worried of whether or not we can afford the ideal US or UK education. So you must be very well planned. At this stage, I suggest that you do build a good relationship and good trust with your parents because even as Rajiv sir said, this is what will help you. Because if your parents know that you're working hard and if they see that you are trying your best, they will go 5 steps ahead and they will try their best to make sure that you get what you want. So your parents must support you in all your endeavors at this point because it's very necessary. I believe that the only reason I was able to do it because I had immense support from my parents. So you do have two options. You have financial aid and you have scholarships. Now these two are nothing the same. Now financial aid is solely based on money. That is how much money your family owns, how much property you have, your income, wealth, everything of that sort is taken into consideration. How good you are as a student does not matter when it comes to financial aid. They will only see that if your family does not have the required income for them to be able to send you to college and sustain their home back wherever they are, then the college will decide to give you a certain stipulated amount as financial aid. Now, there is no consideration given to merit, as I said. And you have to apply for financial aid through a separate form called FAFSA. It's the free application for federal student aid. Now, this is what your family, your parents have to fill. They have to give their bank statements and everything of this sort. So, you must read a lot about this because I can't just explain it verbally. It has a lot to do with finances. Then financial aid to a certain extent reduces chances of getting in. Because say I have applicant A and applicant B. Now applicant A and B are equally talented, they have the same marks, the same SAT scores, equally good letters of recommendation, equally good extracurriculars. But applicant A wants financial aid. but applicant B is ready to pay the amount. So as a commercial college, ultimately even the college needs to make money. So whom will they choose? Obviously the candidate who's able to pay the money and is equally talented. So when you apply for financial aid, do keep in mind that very competitive colleges like MIT, Harvard, Stanford will kind of reduce your chances of getting in by say a 5 or 10%. So you must keep all this in mind. So when you apply, make sure that you apply to colleges that you are sort of sure you will get into. So know your level, and it's very important to make a comprehensive list of colleges which have a few safety schools, medium schools and very top schools. Now scholarship is given only on the basis of your merit. So if the college feels that you are amongst the best students of their incoming batch, they will choose to give you a scholarship. Now that's what I did. I did not apply for financial aid. I just selected the button which says scholarship. So after I got it, Cornell offered me a 10K scholarship, which I obviously accepted. So that's how it works. Scholarship will be given to you after you get into the college on the basis of how good you are in their incoming class. Now the Ivy League, because this is something that most of us find very dicey, whether or not we will get it, whether we're sure. But let me tell you, I was in the same position as you people may be right now, thinking whether it's a good decision to apply to an Ivy or not. But I say go ahead, you never know, you may just have very excellent shot at getting in. So don't be afraid. If you want to apply, go ahead and apply. You just have to fill the required criteria. And after that, you just leave the rest. Go ahead, don't be afraid. At least try to apply for something, even if you think it's out of your reach, because that's what I do. Harvard has a 3.5 acceptance rate, so out of every 100 students, only 3.5 managed to get in. So even though I knew these statistics, I did try and apply, because even though I got rejected, that's not a big deal. You do manage to get into some colleges that do surprise you. So when I got into Penn, I was very surprised. So I do suggest that you should apply to Ivy Leagues without being afraid. Now, what do they look for? Ultimately, these are very elite schools. So the richest kids of the states do attend these colleges, just like you all will. So you must keep in mind that they do look for a very high symbol of elitism in your application. So they will look for very good progress. So your marks do have to be high. I mean, there's no running away from the fact that they will not take you in if your SAT is a 1200. They will not do that. So the recommended SAT for an Ivy League, assuming that the rest of your application is good, your marks are good as well, will be a 1400 to a 1450. That's the required minimum. And for ACT, at least a 34 and 36. Because I don't think people with lower marks than these actually get it, no matter how easy it may seem, that doesn't happen. So make sure that your marks are very good. Then, excellent essays. So something that they find exemplary in your application will be shown only through your essay. So your essay has to be great. No room for grammatical errors, punctuation mistakes, all that doesn't work with an Ivy. So do make sure you get your essays proofread and well checked. Now I just have a table here to help you all with each Ivy League and how each is different from the other, because each has its own criteria for admissions. Now Brown, Columbia and Dartmouth are very good with literature, so don't apply to these colleges if you're looking for science, because that's not very recommended. Yale, Harvard and Cornell are very good for business and law. Penn and Harvard will be the best for business. So as you can see the acceptance rates, which is right in the first column, you will know that Cornell, Dartmouth and Princeton, Yale and Columbia have a higher acceptance rate than the rest, because these are a little easier colleges to get into in the Ivy range. So maybe I guess that's why I got into Cornell, because the Harvard and Yale are quite difficult to attack. So if you're looking for Harvard, Princeton and Yale, which are called the Holy Trinity, do keep in mind that the acceptance in these colleges is very, very low. And even as an international student, you do not have as many chances of getting in, because only the best ones from everywhere manage to make it to these schools. So don't worry, because I just have a little bit of motivation for you all. Your end result looks something like this. So even you will get to see this if you just manage to get through, say through this year. So just start from Illinois and then from Bath and Georgia. And then again from UC San Diego and New York University. That's it. Thank you.